you're not good enough at ultrasound, that's not an excuse to punish your patients with radiation.
Get out there, ultrasound some hearts, some lungs, some IVCs. Let us know how you feel about it.
He's slightly intoxicated. You know, got his wrist pained by doing over-aggressive high fives to his buddies.
Hey, everyone. Before we get started, a couple of things to tell you. First off, we haven't mentioned CastFest for a while because it's been sold out since September. And I'm only mentioning it now to let you know we're actually taking down the waiting list button. There are too many people on the waiting list. We don't want to give anyone false hope of getting in. Sorry. But if you've registered, we can't wait to see you. It's going to be amazing. Now, Introduction to Bedside Ultrasound, the ebooks. So last episode, we announced that this was free forever on both iTunes and Inkling.com. But then our excitement was immediately tempered as we found out that Inkling.com was removing all titles that weren't quote-unquote enterprise titles. So they make no money by distributing our ebooks, so it won't be on their site anymore. We spoke with them and convinced them to leave them on the site till March 1st. Anyone who has the title by then will be able to view it on their computer or on the Inkling app, on their smartphone or their tablet, forever. But no one new can download after March 1st. So please download before then if you think you'll ever want it, and spread the word to any colleagues, fellow residents, medical students, paramedics, or any medical personnel. We're very frustrated by this with as much resources and time as we put into getting it into the Inkling store. Make it worth our time by downloading it, learning, and delivering better care. Now, let's learn together.
Hey, podcast listeners. On the last episode, you had a golly of a good time hearing about a case of cardiac arrest that went exceptionally well. So well, in fact, if Matt were telling the story, you'd probably assume it was completely made up. If you didn't watch that episode, stop what you're doing, rewind your podcast player, and listen to that one first. On this podcast, we have his Kentuckiness, Dr. Sam Ghali, telling us about another one of his echo adventures with illness. For those of you that missed it, Sam is ultrasound director, fellowship director, and generally Mr. Important when it comes to anything ultrasound at the University of Kentucky. I hear they had a real void in that position before Sam got there. At the end of the last episode, I set Sam up for failure by commenting on how I imagine Sam as a lytics maestro who has phenomenal outcomes every time he uses them in critically ill patients. Sam, take it away with another one of your success stories.
Okay, so this is a story of a 70-year-old lady who I found out about through sign out. A patient was signed out to me at checkout, and I think it was one of those where the provider saw her right before checkout, and he wasn't really able to leave her for me because she was pretty sick. So the sign out I got was CHF, a patient's on a norepinephrine drip. That was basically it. Yeah, so what happened was shortly after...
So you gave her TNK for CHF exacerbation?
Yeah, exactly.
Come on, Sam. I had more faith in you than that, man.
I gave her TNK. No, so right after sign-out, the nurses were running up to the resident and I, and they were very concerned. She had worsening hypotension, and it looked like she was starting to get altered and really not looking so great. We immediately grabbed the ultrasound machine.
Did a quick right upper quadrant ultrasound.
Yeah, so we put the probe on the heart and literally couldn't see much of anything at all. You could see that there was some sort of amorphous, blob moving, and you couldn't make out any of the chambers. And so this is something that you tend to not want to do because the patient's sick. They're hypotensive. They might be hypoxemic. They're probably altered. But if you really want to get a view, and I really want to get a view in these patients who are hypotensive, especially if they're,
you put in a TEE probe, right?
Especially if they're going into to shock. Yeah. So TEE probe, if you have it. If not, just a simple left lateral decubitus position, and get people to help you. All of a sudden, it changes a lot. You can.
That's a great pearl, Sam. I think that people underestimate the left lateral decube, and it doesn't always have to be completely rolled over on the left. I mean, even sometimes just a pillow under the right shoulder is enough to get to improve your image to the point that you can make diagnostic decisions. So that's a good pearl. I think we should do that more often.
Totally agree, Mike. I mean, it can go from seeing nothing to seeing everything you need to. Yeah. So anyway, we were able to obtain this apical 4 And what we see here is looking at the right heart here, the right ventricle, and comparing it to the left ventricle, and you look at the chamber size, and normally we're looking for about 2-to-1 ratio, 1 to 0.6, but more simply 2-to-1. And here the RV looks not only as big as the LV, but actually looks bigger.
Yeah, it's huge, right? I mean, this is definitely concerning. Had this lady had not gotten a lot of fluid either, right? Because your provider thought that she was in heart failure. So I assume that she's probably being fluid restricted and just receiving norepi, right?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Very little fluid.
So in this case, we can't blame it on iatrogenic. I've seen a few cases of patients where I've taken over care of a patient who the provider thought to be septic, and you know, they same things happen. They become hypotensive. I've done an echo and seen similar images to this, but in those cases, they were all iatrogenic fluid overload. So important to remember, like, what has happened to the patient before you got there with your ultrasound machine that could have created the image that you're currently seeing. But I assume, seeing this image, you were probably thinking to yourself, whoa, this isn't heart failure.
Yeah, you're exactly right, Mike. And, you know, we talked about the RV. I mean, if you look at the left atrium as well, and again, this isn't the greatest image all in all, but pretty good for this was a very large lady. She probably weighed about 200 kilos. But if you look at the ratio of the right atrium to the left atrium, you could see that the right atrium is huge as well. You look up here at the apex, and I would go ahead and call that a McConnell sign.
Okay, fair enough. So far you've told me this lady has an RV that's bigger than the LV, an RA that's bigger than the LA, and a McConnell sign. So I kind of get the feeling, Sam, that you're pushing me towards PE. Is that what you're trying to tell me?
Yeah, that's exactly, those were exactly the thoughts.
So what else do you look for in these patients that you suspect PE, other than just the size of the right heart and the presence of a McConnell sign? Because I think we know that those aren't necessarily diagnostic, right? I mean, they could be suggestive, but is there anything else that we can use to help push us towards that diagnosis of PE?
Yeah, so great question, Mike. And this next clip, I think this is a mislabeled here, so don't pay attention to that. But I think this is one of the most underappreciated views when you're trying to assess for an acute massive or submassive pulmonary embolism. This is a parasternal short. Not only can you really appreciate the RV-LV ratio, I mean, when you look here, the RV, it's basically dwarfing the LV on this shot. But another key point here, one of my favorite things to look for is you see the septum here, and it's actually getting flattened out by the volume and the pressure overload during systole and early diastole. You see it flatten out, and it almost looks like a capital D, and we call that the D sign.
Sure. So telling us that the pressure on the right side of the heart at some point is greater than the pressure on the left side of the heart, pushing that septum down in towards the left ventricle, right?
And you actually see it. You see the septum, not only is it getting flattened out, it's also bowing into the LV from all that pressure. And so we have paradoxical motion of the septum as well.
It almost looks to me too that left ventricle is smaller than normal. It doesn't appear to have a very large. It's not filling very much. How about that? Suggesting that the fluid just isn't getting from the right side of the heart to the left side of the heart.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. Even on the apical four, we appreciated that as well. We see here that, you know, we look at the RV-LV ratio, but the left heart just looks completely underfilled.
And hyperdynamic too, right? EF of like 104 or 105%.
Sure, yeah, and certainly not, certainly not systolic heart failure.
Yeah, definitely not. So, what about Doppler? Can that help us at all in these sorts of cases?
So let's go to a Doppler image I have here. I threw some color Doppler on, and you can see some obvious tricuspid regurgitation here. You see the jet coming through from the right ventricle through the tricuspid valve and regurgitating into the right atrium.
So what information does that add more than what you already have, though? Tell me why that's actually helpful, or is it?
So that's to me, that's another piece of the puzzle here. You know, we're assessing for right heart strain. We've talked about all the things we've already seen. Now we're seeing a regurgitant jet, and not only does that point more towards right heart strain, but probably suggests a worsening degree as well.
So, Sam, not to be devil's advocate, but being devil's advocate, all you've really done is proven to me that this lady has chronic pulmonary hypertension, and she's got core pulmonale, and that's why she's hypotensive.
So I'm really glad you brought that up, Mike, because, and I tell my residents this all the time, if you're assessing somebody for right heart strain and your concern is an acute pulmonary embolism, just take the 10 seconds it takes to look at the bilateral groins, look in the pops if you have to, because you just might find another piece of evidence that really sways you. And here's the, we have the linear probe here looking at the right femoral, common femoral vein. Here's the saphenous coming in. Here's the right femoral artery. And we see this massive clot in the common femoral vein, a completely non-compressible, echogenic.
Nice. Now, so I think you've won me over, Sam. I believe you now. She's got a PE. But before, I wasn't convinced that it wasn't just pulmonary hypertension. Is there anything on echo that we can use to help differentiate the chronic versus the acute right heart failure?
Yeah, so aside from looking in the looking towards the groins and the pops and looking for an acute thrombus to sway you over, you can look for things like right ventricular hypertrophy. Sometimes you see these RVs that are just really thick, and it just looks chronic. The hard part about that is that those patients are usually at risk for acute PEs on top of their chronic RV strain and failure as well.
That's a great point. So if there's evidence of right heart hypertrophy, or basically a thickness of the RV free wall greater than 5 millimeters, then that would be suggestive of long-standing pulmonary hypertension, which could attribute to why your patient's hypotensive or hypoxic, or even why their heart looks like this on echo. But in this case, it looks like there's not any right ventricular hypertrophy, and this person probably had a normal heart before that big clot that was in their groin made it up to the the saddle embolus.
Yeah, I totally agree with you, Mike. One thing I just happened to notice here, I was just scrolling through these clips. You notice here that I have it on harmonic penetration. So that just, and I didn't even realize this till I just looked at this. I had forgotten about it. We really had to decrease the frequency and go up on the penetration in order to get a view here.
Hello, lady. So you got a lady with right heart failure. She's got every echo finding in the book for right heart failure. She's got a ginormous clot sitting in her leg. So you just discharged her? I mean, is that the next step in this patient? intubation, 6 liters of IV fluids, and admission to the floor.
Okay, so yeah, so this is a. This is a great example of how echo really changes management here. As I said, the ongoing working diagnosis was CHF, and clearly we're not seeing CHF, and not only that, but we're seeing obvious signs that point towards nothing but a massive acute pulmonary embolism. At this point, the decision was made to go ahead and push TNK. The patient really really wasn't looking good at all. As I said, she was starting to get altered. Her blood pressure, I think, was somewhere around 60 over 40 on norepinephrine. And so we pushed again 50th to neck to place. And I believe we started, we gave her Lovenox as well. And the critical care guys and the cardiologists were all down in the ED looking at these clips and discussing the case with them.
That sounds totally appropriate. I think I would have done the exact same thing. You've got a hypotensive patient with evidence of clot, right heart failure. You push lytics and cross your fingers, right? Unless you've got an ECMO lab somewhere that you can send the patient to, which I assume you guys don't right now.
Yeah. So we pushed the lytics and gave the Lovenox, and we wished and hoped for the best for her. Care was taken over by critical care. And she was admitted to the intensive care unit. What happened, what I did after my shift was I decided I wanted to follow up and go see how she was doing. I had talked to the family and everything. And so I actually went up to the unit. I learned that she was intubated. And with discussion with her and the family beforehand was that she was okay with intubation, but they wanted absolutely no chest compressions if she were to code, and they wanted medications only. So I actually was in the unit and got some additional clips. Here's one.
Well, that doesn't look very positive.
Yeah, so she wasn't doing very well. This is an interesting clip in that we see one beat, and then you see the heart kind of swaying over to the left here. And I think what we're seeing here is one intrinsic beat and then a ventilation through the ET tube. Interestingly, we can see a McConnell sign even on this one single weak beat that she had. I did happen to put color flow back on as well, and you can see the TR is just worsened. If you want to compare it to what the TR looked like beforehand.
Yeah. And this was what, a couple hours after giving TNK. So it looks to me like you probably just haven't been able to reduce that clot burden enough, and you're getting progressive right ventricular failure, which is probably what's going on here.
Yeah. Yeah. I think you're absolutely right, Mike.
Oh, that's an interesting clip there.
Yeah, this is an interesting clip. You see some motion here. That's not intrinsic cardiac activity. What we're seeing here again is a ventilation. And, I think this is, probably epinephrine, being given. Again, she didn't want chest compression. So, this is an asystolic cardiac standstill heart with meds being pushed, and you can see it swirling here in the right atrium and going into the RV.
So, yeah, I hear you. Epi or meds are obviously not going to work just sitting in the right side of the heart without compressions to circulate it, but I'm sure that's all they had, so they tried it.
Man, tough case, but I think I'm glad you shared it, Sam, because it does highlight all of the important aspects of echo during a suspected pulmonary embolism, and more importantly, it highlights the concept that when something's going on with a patient that's unusual, just take a look, just see what's going on. You get signed out on a patient that's supposed to be heart failure, and they're becoming more hypotensive. You don't really know anything about them. Might as well take a look and make sure that initial diagnosis was the right one.
Yeah, you know, not all cases are going to end with a happy ending, but like you said, for me, anytime a patient is hypotensive, and certainly if they're in shock, there's no way I'm going to feel comfortable taking care of the patient without an ultrasound, without an echo, and even if I know nothing else. If I can just get one thing and look at what the ejection fraction is, I mean, even if you put tamponade and acute signs of acute PE And all the other things we can see with ultrasound, if I can just, if nothing else, get an ejection fraction. Is this patient in shock with an EF of 10% or are they in shock with an EF of 75%? I think that's a huge piece of information.
Thank you, Sam. Thank you for coming on and telling us not about all just your saves, but also some of your losses, because it's educational for all of us.
Absolutely. Thank you guys very much for having me. Mike, it was my pleasure.
Great case, Sam. This reminds me of something I'm always harping on the residents about. Be careful of your sign outs. Just because the doc before you has a diagnosis and a plan doesn't mean they're right. They might not have all the information you have, or, in Sam's case, the wherewithal to drop a probe on a patient's chest and groin. When sign-out patients get sick, you've got to approach them with a fresh set of eyes. Keep your mind open and don't pigeonhole yourself into a diagnosis you were given. Another great learning point about this case is that cardiac ultrasound is not highly sensitive or specific for a QPE. Sam didn't give lytics because the patient had RV strain or flattened septum or severe TR. He gave lytics because the patient had all of those things and a big clot sitting in her thigh. We know from the literature that a positive likelihood ratio for RV strain predicting pulmonary embolism is low, like 3.5 low, and that's not enough to make treatment decisions in stable and sometimes even mildly unstable patients. For that reason, on my watch, patients with suspected PE that can go to a CT scanner go before I push lytics. Now, obviously, Sam couldn't have sent this lady to the scanner. She was sick. He had to depend on ultrasound diagnosis. Now, would he have pushed lytics without a DVT clot? Hard to say. I'm not even sure what I would have done. That patient could have easily had an echo with chronic pulmonary hypertension and chronic RV failure. The only way to really know would have been to try to measure the RV free wall and see if it was hypertrophied, suggesting chronic RV failure. So let's break this down. This stuff gets complicated. You've got a sick, hypotensive patient with no prior medical history and a story consistent with acute pulmonary embolism. You do a bedside echo and you do see evidence of RV strain. Now, first let's look at the legs. Let's see if there's a clot. If there is a clot, boom, diagnosis. If not, that's where things get a little tricky. So here are your options. One, you can try to get the patient over to CT for a CTPA. Just don't blame me when you hear overhead the call of the patient resting in the scanner. Two, we can look at the lungs. Now, this study talks about a positive likelihood ratio of 15 if there's subpleural consolidations. See how you see these consolidations just under the pleura? These are actually pulmonary infarcts. This is a really interesting study that I'd like to see repeated, but maybe worth a shot if you're trying to make the decision about treating somebody or not, and you're just on the fence. And three is your option to cowboy up. Just push the lytics. Now, sure, you might drip a patient with chronic disease, but you've decided the benefit outweighs the risk. Now, I can't think of a situation in medicine where there's more disagreement about the right thing to do. Unfortunately, I don't have an answer for you here today. You're going to have to go out there and find one for yourself. You need to have a mental conversation with yourself about your own risk tolerance. Are you okay being the guy that gave TPA to someone who had a bleed because you thought they had a PE? Are you convinced they have a PE and the cardiac ultrasound was just enough to push you over the edge? Tough questions and, like I said, no great answer. This one we're just going to have to take on a case-by-case basis and even maybe a discussion with the patient and the family. Now, what I can say is that if you take the opportunity to look at the heart and find RV strain, and then you go down to the legs and you find a clot, that's the easy one. That's the easy diagnosis that every one of us should be able to make, because they could be life-saving, even if it wasn't in this case that Sam had.
EMC, summarize.
Yeah. To all my EPs diagnosed with PEs. Chapter 2, the EMC. Check it out now. Yeah. So this right here is right ventricular strain, the right topic in particular to stick in your brain. See, it's important to test the patient undifferentiated shortness of breath. See, it's an alphabet soup. Chief complaint CC is SOB. What's the DDX? Is it COPD? ACS, CHF exacerbation. What if it happens to be actually a massive PE, a big clot in the lungs? Uh-oh, I'll kill you quick as getting shot with a gun. It's not the one you wanna miss, an echo's got to be done. Strain displays in many ways, so let's go over some. Number one, the ratio
ratio is 1-to-1 or less. Chamber size of the right to left. And when the right heart is strained and dilated, this rule is violated. And even an amateur, apical four or paracernal short view brandisher can find a way to identify these diameters. Next, you're gonna do number two is essential. Sometimes the only sign you'll find there's something detrimental. High PA pressures create a pressure differential. So the septum gets pushed to the left, right heart strain pushes the septum to the left. And this feature, please, simple as ABCs. D-shaped left ventricle, you'll pick it up with ease. And of course, a plethoric IVC is number three. And before we explore number four, I wanna mention and underscore what happens in pulmonary hypertension. Blood can't flow forward, a clot blocks and deflects it and forces it back towards the opposite direction. Tricuspid valves start to leak slightly and then regurgitate blood like a GI bleed. And the degree of tricuspid insufficiency can simply tell you what the right heart pressures are instantly. It's truly amazing. Measure PA pressures using Bernoulli's equation or a simplified version of it. First, identify the regurgitant jet. Get your apical four view, and this might sound awkward. Just turn on your color and your pulse wave Doppler. Measure the velocity in meters per second, and if it's greater than 3, it's pulmonary hypertension. So to do the calculation, let's all geek out and we'll go through the equation. It's velocity squared multiply times 4 plus your CVP. 4 up the thoric IVC will be 20 or more. If you're not too ADHD, ADD those together. Get your PA pressures and MMHG. You should know the normal pressures. Remember the numbers, age of Hugh Hefner's wives, 25 and under. And in case you forgot, pulmonary hypertension's got a lot of etiologies, not just a clot. So you wanna know the difference between new or old sickness? The trick is, look at the RV wall thickness. In chronic hypertension, the wall's hypertrophy with thicker dimensions. So another tip to mention, if you're thinking PE, slide to the thighs, analyze for DVT. Not cause it's sensitive, but if it's present, it's specific. Embolism maybe with it makes a difference between giving heparin and even lytics. It's the EMC saying handle your business. We're finished with chapter 2, and after, more to do. So take these words home and think it through, and the next life saved might be because of you.
If you're not good enough at ultrasound, that's not an excuse to punish your patients with radiation.
Get out there, ultrasound some hearts, some lungs, some IVCs. Let us know how you feel about it.